Network is live at the United Nations here in New York City. Kevin.
Greta, you're right. And very interesting, right, that just ahead of this private meeting that has been much talked about, the two men using a very public forum to air their longstanding differences, both men accusing the other's policies for being the reason for all the unrest in places like Syria, for example. And I found it in particular very interesting that President Obama seemed to once again say that he would not have a problem in working with the Russians or even the Iranians, for that matter, if it would make a difference in Syria. But you have to wonder how seriously the Russians will take that offer, given their position right now, which is to try to prop up the Assad regime. Greta?
Kevin, how long did they meet?
Surprisingly, quite a long time. Now, going into this, we didn't really have an actual readout. We kind of figured they might meet for 15 minutes, 20 minutes. But believe it or not, the two leaders, we are under the impression that they met for at least more than an hour. In fact, I want to double check this. Would you say more than 2 hours, Lisa? 95 minutes is what we are told at this late hour. So that's a real surprise from this vantage point because, as you know, I wouldn't say they're best of friends, Greta.
Is there any indication anyone sort of doing a victory dance that anything was accomplished, that either one of these two world leaders saw anything in common or seemed to resolve anything or move forward on anything?
I've had a very good conversation with a senior administration official prior to this meeting, and without wanting to give away too much, his position was you should expect very little to happen. You should expect the 2 minutes to talk about their differences, but if you're looking for something to really hang on to as a result of this meeting, you probably will leave this meeting wanting. But keep in mind, that senior official also told me, Greta, that the meeting wouldn't last very long, 15 minutes, maybe 30. It went more than 90, and that could bode well for both men.
All right, Kevin, I saw one thing today where they're both sort of dueling over who asked who for the meeting. Is that we resolved it? Did Putin ask Obama or did Obama ask Putin?
I had a feeling you might ask me that. The official line is, Putin asked Obama, but I also think you can take from this this very little nugget, and I think this will probably be instructive for everybody listening at home. John Kerry, the Secretary of State, meeting with his counterparts several times. So you get the sense that both sides were really reaching out to the other, although officially we are told it was Putin who asked for this particular meeting.
Kevin, thank you. And just hours before Russian President Vladimir Putin addressed the UN General Assembly and met with President Obama, President Putin sat down on 60 Minutes. Now, during that interview, just 24 hours ago, Putin talked about Russia's place in the world and Russia's sphere of influence in the region.
There are those who look at Ukraine, especially Ukraine and Georgia, and they believe that you do not want to recreate the Soviet Empire, but you do want to recreate a sphere of influence which you think Russia deserves because of the relationship that has existed. Why are you smiling? Why?
You're making me happy because we're always suspected of some ambitions and they always try to distort something or hint at something. I indeed said that I believe that the collapse of the USSR was a huge tragedy of the 20th century. You know why? Because first of all, in an instant, 25 million Russian people found themselves beyond the borders of the Russian state. Do you think it's normal that 25 million Russian people were abroad all of a sudden? Russia was the biggest divided nation in the world. It's not a problem? Well, maybe not for you, but it's a problem for me.
Former Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich goes on the record. Good evening, Mr. Speaker. And we certainly had dueling speeches at the UN between President Obama and then President Putin, and then they met. Your thoughts today about that?
I think we're seeing a continuing collapse of the Obama policy. You now have Russia firmly in Syria. You have Russia, Iran, and Iraq working together with Syria. All these are things that 3 or 4 years ago the president would have deeply opposed. And now he's going to have to accommodate a reality that he can't change.
Well, the news that that Russia, Iraq, Iran, and Syria are working together, they're going to share intelligence, we're left out of that equation? Is that how you understand it? And if so, why are we left out of it?
Look, I think we have watched a steady decline of American influence under President Obama. The Iranians have been trying to develop a regional hegemony. The Russians have now become their ally. I think what you're seeing is a tremendous shift of power away from the United States and Western Europe towards Russia and Iran. And it's a strategic defeat, a very dramatic defeat in historical terms.
Well, obviously, our nation has a deep interest in protecting our ally Israel there. But putting that aside just for the moment, does this mean that Russia is saying that Syria is their problem, that ISIS is their problem, and it's not our problem?
Well, I think Putin is saying that he's going to make sure that Assad survives as a dictator. He's going to cooperate actively with the Iranians. He's going to increasingly sell weapons to the Iraqis. And if we want to hang around, that's fine. We just don't matter very much to him.
And what does that mean? What does that mean for Americans, everyday Americans, as they watch this?
Well, it means your country has lost substantial authority and prestige and power, that we are in a much weaker position, and that we are running bigger risks.
All right. Let me go back to your former job as Speaker of the House. Speaker Boehner, he says, yeah, I'm out of here. He's getting out. What do you think about him announcing his resignation at the end? It'll be effective end of October.
I think he was very worn out. I think he also was faced with a rebellion on his right that he couldn't stop and couldn't deal with. And I think, frankly, Clista and I were with him and with Debbie when the Pope was in town. The high point of John Boehner's public career will always have been being there with Pope Francis. I think it meant an immense amount to him. The Pope blessed his grandchild. It was just a remarkable moment for him. And I think sort of that evening he said, this is it. I mean, it ain't getting any better than this. I'm gone.
But does he leave the GOP broken on Capitol Hill in the House?
No. He gives Kevin McCarthy, who's going to be Speaker, an opportunity now to step in, to actually have better relations with the right, at least for the moment, and maybe to put together a new leadership team with new energy, new ideas, and new drive. The system moves on. There's no vacuum. And by a month from now, we'll see McCarthy, I think, being a very aggressive and very vigorous speaker.
What can he do differently than Speaker Boehner?
I think Kevin is a lot more focused on communications. I think you'll see him be much more aggressive, both in pushing the Senate and in taking on President Obama. And you've already heard him say that he is committed to, for example, creating a select committee on Planned Parenthood and the cutting up of babies. That's a significant step in the right direction. He's apparently going to continue his commitment to oppose the Ex-Im Bank. That's a huge decision, and I'm sure will shake corporate America. But I think you're going to see McCarthy pleasant but firm and very smart. This is a guy who's had a very long career in public service and knows the business very well.
Mr. Speaker, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Vladimir Putin, not the only world leader with a strained relationship with the United States to address the United Nations. Iranian President Hassan Rouhani placed the blame for the rise of terror in the Middle East squarely on the United States.
We will not forget the past, but we do not wish to live in the past. We will not forget war and sanctions, but we look to peace and development. If we did not have the U.S. military invasion of Afghanistan and Iraq and the U.S.'s United States' unwarranted support for the inhumane actions of the Zionist regime against the oppressed nation of Palestine, today the terrorists would not have an excuse for the justification of their crime.
Former U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, John Bolton, joins us live from the U.N. Good evening, Mr. Ambassador. And one of the other meetings that happened today were President Putin and Iran's President Rouhani. What does that tell us?
Well, I think it shows the flow of power across the Middle East. I think Russia has clearly made a strategic decision to challenge the United States for dominance in the region. Putin demonstrated in his speech today he's got a strategy. He thinks he knows what Russia's interests are. Our president was kind of floating in the clouds somewhere, and his actions over the past 6.5 years, I think, have demonstrated a lack of interest in the Middle East other than to get an Israeli settlement with the Palestinians. I think the clearest sign of weakness that Putin and Rouhani must have been chuckling over is the Vienna deal on Iran's nuclear weapons program, which signaled a complete surrender by the United States of its key demand. So good day for Rouhani, and that comment about the U.S. causing international terrorism gets him the chutzpah of the day award.
What do you think President Obama thinks after today's activities? First, he spoke at the UN, then President Putin. He met with President Putin, and then Rouhani and Putin met. Well, what do you think President Obama takes away from today?
I think he believes it's another example of his successful foreign policy of reducing American influence in the region. There's just no other explanation for what he's trying to do other than reduce our profile. And the consequence, of course, is that power abhors a vacuum, and Putin and Rouhani see an opportunity and they're moving to exploit it. That's what Russia's new air base in Syria is about. That's what the deal is with Iraq. I don't like to call it Iraq. It's really the rump government in Baghdad controlled by Tehran. They are showing that they can put together an alliance as ours disintegrate.
Well, the alliance being Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Russia, and with the United States left out. So as people across America are watching this, the same question I posed to Speaker Gingrich is, what difference does it make to Americans, you know, let them have the mess, so to speak?
Well, the difference it makes is that in an area that's absolutely critical to the world's economy, Russia's power and influence is dramatically enhanced and ours is reduced. The threat to the oil-producing monarchies of the Arabian Peninsula, both from Iran and from ISIS, is now enhanced. The Arab states and Israel, I think, are now hedging their bets about America's involvement in the region as a whole. I think you're either going to get greater chaos with all kinds of implications, both for Israel and for oil prices, or greater Russian involvement in an area that we've tried to keep them out of for 50 years.
And Mr. Ambassador, it's just the AP is just reporting that after the meeting between President Obama and President Putin, that Russia does not rule out joining air attacks on ISIS. Your thoughts about that?
That contradicts what Putin said the other day. Clearly, the administration has misunderstood Putin and Assad for 6.5 years, ever since the Syrian civil war broke out. The president, Hillary Clinton, John Kerry have all said Russia will partner with the United States to ease Assad out of power. That was never true. It was always wrong. And now you can see the consequences.
All right, a quick question out left field. I would rather speak last, not first. How is it arranged that, like, for instance, President Obama spoke before President Rouhani? How do they do that in the U.N.?
Because since time immemorial, meaning 1946, Brazil has spoken first and the United States has spoken second. Why does Brazil speak first? I once knew, but I've forgotten.
All right. Well, we know we speak second anyway, so that's solved. Anyway, Ambassador Bolton, thank you, sir.